Hello and welcome dear students. Welcome to the lecture on revision. Revision of your entire portion of CA final direct tax is going to be done in the course of these videos. So, first of all, this is only a revision lecture. So, there is not going to be any explanation of any logic or any provision in detail. This lecture is strongly on the ground that your entire portion is already studied by you. I will be telling you the provisions, like very quickly I will be telling you this chapter, this is the chapter, these are the important sections, and in this manner I will be proceeding in the lecture that I am delivering to you right now. As far as amendments are concerned, I will be telling you about the amendments. Again, for detailed explanation of amendments, we have a separate lecture, amendment lecture, which can be opted. So, detailed explanation will not take place with respect to anything. Obviously, there cannot be any problem solving. One after the other, sequentially, I will be telling you chapters and the revision of the chapters. Very quickly, I will tell you what is there in which chapter and what is important for exam, what is not. And this lecture is going to be delivered in 100% English language. 100% English. Specially recorded for students of South India who have got language problem. So, all the delivery of, the entire delivery of lecture here is going to be in English. For those students who are comfortable with a mixture of Hindi and English, which is natural delivery of lectures, you can opt for another version of the same lecture, which is in the mixture of English and Hindi. This lecture will be used without using a single Hindi word. And this lecture will be in the order of my textbook. My textbook means when I issue you a textbook and I divide my chapters into volume 1, unrelated topics of CA final, volume 2, unrelated topics of related topics of CA final, volume 3, IPCC portion. As we remember, as we know, only one faculty in India will teach you all those topics. In the order of the textbook that I have issued, I will be doing with you the revision strictly in the order of the textbook that I have issued to you, strictly in that order. And everything will be just a recollect of what we have studied throughout our, most of you all I believe will be full course student. This lecture is actually meant for those students who are in full course only. And because the detailed explanation has already been done, now only a revision is required, and I will try to keep the timing in as short as possible. Minimum duration, maximum coverage is what my intention is going to be. So without wasting anytime, this was just the introduction of what we are going to cover. Amendments will be informed, not taught in detail. Revision will be done, no section will be gone or done in detail. It is only going to be a revision, not any explanation. Question answers are not going to be covered. All these things are separately covered. Amendment course is separately recorded. Question answer course is separately available. Full detail explanation in full course is separately available. This is only going to be very quick revision. Let's go in the order of the textbook that I have issued. Very first chapter that we have in our textbook is a chapter called Introduction, wherein after introducing the subject, I give you slab rates for the year. So, first of all, there is absolutely no change. Also, let me tell you, this revision lecture is for May 20 and November 20 exams. The same lecture is going to work for both. For both exams, the applicable previous year is going to be previous year 1920. For both exams, the applicable assessment year is going to be assessment year 2021. And therefore, this lecture is going to work good well for students appearing in both exams, November 20 as well as May 20. Both students can opt for this lecture, and we are revising the full portion. So, when I am giving you any provision, for example, tax rates also applicable for May 20 and November 20, very first chapter introduction where we discuss our tax rates. In the very first chapter introduction, we discuss our tax rates. In slab rates, there is no change. So, individual below 60 years or non-resident of any age, first 250 no tax, then up to 5 lakh it will be 5%, up to 10 lakh it will be 20%, after 10 lakh it will be 30%. Only if you are resident senior or very senior citizen, it has to be a resident. Resident of the age 60 to 79, basic exemption will be 3 lakh, remaining will be same, up to 5 lakh 5%, up to 10 lakh 20%, balance will be 30%. And resident of the age 80 years and above, up to 5 lakh no tax, then 20% and 30%. So, there is absolutely no change in your slab rates. As we are aware, higher basic exemption limit will be available only if you are a resident. Next concept after calculating basic tax is the concept of rebate. Rebate is applicable when you satisfy three conditions. First condition, you have to be a resident. Second condition, you have to be individual. Third condition, which has undergone amendment. The eligibility criteria of rebate was till last year, if your income is up to rupees 3,50,000. Now this eligibility criteria is increased. People having income up to rupees 5 lakh will be eligible for rebate. So that is also an amendment. I will not be going into the detail of the amendment. I will just be telling you the amendment. Resident individual entity up to rupees 5 lakh is now going to be eligible for rebate. And what is the quantum of rebate? Actual tax or 12,500, whichever is lower. So second amendment in the concept of rebate. Till last year the maximum rebate was 2,500. Now the maximum rebate is 12,500. Within the concept of rebate we have two amendments. First amendment, eligibility criteria increased from 3,50,000 to 5 lakh rupees. And second amendment, the quantum of rebate maximum, it is always going to be compared with actual tax. Actual tax or 2,500, whichever is lower, will now become actual tax or 12,500, whichever is lower. Therefore, any person having income exact 5 lakh, first to 50 no tax, then up to 5 lakh, 5% will be 12,500, and that 12,500 will become zero because of rebate. And because of this, very smartly, in a very clever manner, this came in the interim budget. So interim finance minister CA Piyush Goyal sir, he very smartly made an announcement in the parliament. People having income up to rupees 5 lakh, there will be no tax liability. And suddenly everybody started saying basic exemption limit is changed. No, please, basic exemption limit is not changed. It was 250 earlier, it is 250 now also. Only if you have income up to 5 lakh, because of rebate it will become zero. But any SSE having income 5 lakh and 10 rupees, listen, tax up to 5 lakh will be 12,500, and then on 10 rupees at 20% it will be 2 rupees. So on 12,502 there will be no rebate because income is crossing 5 lakh and you have to pay your full tax. Your basic exemption is 250 only. The change is only in the eligibility criteria of rebate. If they change basic exemption limit, then they have to give the benefit to the highest income earning categories also. But we wanted to keep the benefit only for poor people. So people earning income up to rupees 5 lakh will not be paying any tax because of rebate. But if it is more than 5 lakh, if it is 5 lakh and 10 rupee also, then you have to pay your normal tax. Your basic exemption is going to remain at 2,50,000 rupees. There is absolutely no change in your basic exemption. In your basic exemption, there is absolutely no change. So only in the rebate there is change. Basic exemption, no change. Now the next concept, surcharge. For individual HUF, AOP, BOI, artificial juridical person, surcharge up to 50 lakh 0%, more than 50 lakh equal to 1 crore 10%, more than 1 crore 15%. These were the existing rates. Within surcharge, as we are aware, two amendments. I am not discussing the amendment in detail. I am just telling you this is a revision lecture. Income exceeding 2 crore up to 5 crore 25% surcharge, and income exceeding 5 crore 37% surcharge. Two new surcharge rates. After 2 crore 25% and after 5 crore 37%, two new rates of surcharge have been introduced by the Finance Act of 2019. But immediately after that, after 2 months, there was a taxation law amendment ordinance on 20th of September, under which they then said that if your income is crossing your 2 crore rupees only because of 111A capital gain, 112A capital gain, or FII 115AD capital gain, if your income is crossing your 2 crore only because of capital gain, then the new surcharge is not going to be applicable. You will continue at 15%. Obviously, you have crossed 1 crore. If you were below 1 crore, then the existing rates will apply. You have crossed 1 crore. Earlier, it was 15. Now, if you cross 2 crore, earlier it was still 15, now it will become 25. But if the reason of crossing is 111A, 112A or 115AD, in that case, the new surcharge will not be applicable. The old surcharge of 15 will continue. But if you have already crossed, say your salary income is only 6 crore and you have already crossed the criteria of 2 crore or 5 crore because of your other income, then the new surcharge rates of 25% and 37% will be applicable. But on the tax that you calculate in 111A, 112A and 115AD capital gains for FIIs, if they are AOP, mind you, this is applicable only for individual HUF, AOP, BOI, AJP. Now, FII cannot be individual HUF. So, if it is AOP, the new surcharge will be applicable only on the other income. On the capital gain part, it is going to be 15% only. So, if your income is less than 2 crore, less than or equal to 2 crore, then your existing surcharge will continue. No amendment is applicable. Amendment is applicable only to those assessees whose income is more than 2 crore, 25% and more than 5 crore, which is also more than 2 crore, 37%. But if this has been crossed only because of your capital gain 111A, 112A or 115AD, then full surcharge will be 15 only, and if it is already crossing the limit, then new surcharge will apply, but on this capital gain part, it is going to be only 15%. The existing surcharge will continue. This change came by way of the ordinance. As far as HEC is concerned, there is absolutely no amendment in HEC. So, HEC will remain. It was 4%. It will remain at 4%. Health and education says on basic plus surcharge if applicable, minus rebate if applicable. Surcharge and rebate obviously cannot come together. So, HEC will be applicable at 4%. So, these are the tax rates applicable for individual HUF, AOPBY, AJP, companies and firm tax rates. Obviously, we discuss in the respective chapter, so we will be revising over there, and there has not been any substantial change in firm taxation. Company taxation has undergone terrible change, immense change, huge change. Huge changes have taken place in company taxation because of the ordinance, but we will talk about it in minimum alternate tax. We will revise everything. This is a revision lecture. That was our first chapter introduction. Now, as I have clarified, my revision lecture will proceed in the order of chapters that I teach you in class as per my textbook. So, after introduction, my next chapter is Double Taxation Avoidance Agreement, also called as treaty, also called as convention, or we call it double taxation relief. There are two types of double taxation. I am revising it with you. Whenever same person on the same income is paying tax twice, that will be juridical double taxation, because same person has paid tax twice, you will be getting relief. But when the same income is becoming taxable for different people, then it will become economic double taxation. Same income tax twice, but for different people. Economic double taxation, there is no relief. So, juridical double taxation, same person, same income paying tax twice, you will get relief. But economic double taxation, same income getting taxed twice, but in the hands of two different people, there is going to be no relief. So, from here onwards, in this chapter, we will talk about only juridical double taxation. There are two types of relief. If there is an agreement between the two countries, then the relief will be as per the agreement, that is called bilateral relief under section 90 and 90A, as per the agreement. So, the calculation will change from agreement to agreement. You have to go and read individual agreement, but individual agreement is not a part of our portion. We are required to learn only the common points. What are the common points? What are the common points? Every agreement will have relief. Every agreement will have exchange of information. Every agreement will have a facility of non-discrimination for non-residents. Non-discrimination for non-residents. The provisions of bilateral relief are optional. So, if you find normal provisions beneficial, you can take that. For there are two methods of providing relief. Tax credit method, where both countries will take tax and one will give you credit of the other. And tax exemption method, where one will take tax, other will leave. Which country will take tax, which country will exempt, which method to be followed, everything will be strictly as per agreement. If you are a resident of that other country, you will have to bring tax residency certificate, TRC. Otherwise, we will not give you relief. So, bilateral relief is dependent from agreement to agreement. Generally, they avoid asking questions because they have to reproduce the clause. And under section 91, we have another concept called unilateral relief. Whenever there is no agreement between the two countries, then there will be no bilateral relief. Then the government of India will come forward to provide you relief. But the first and the most important condition, a SSE has to be a resident. Unilateral relief is going to be provided only if the SSE is, only if the SSE is resident. Only if the SSE is resident. The other conditions are obvious. Income has to be outside India. Tax has to be paid outside India. There should not be any DTAA. Obviously, otherwise you will be covered under bilateral relief. So, unilateral relief will be available only to resident. Under a particular specific calculation given under section 91 of Income Tax Act, and because it is a specific calculation given under section 91 of Income Tax Act, because it is a specific calculation, this is most likely asked in exam. So, you have to find out tax in India and tax abroad. Whichever is lower is the rate at which we will give you relief. Tax in India has to be done by three steps. Step 1, total income in India. Step 2, total tax in India. On this total tax, we will find out the average rate of tax, total tax upon total income, average rate of tax in India. This will be compared with foreign rate of tax, which is going to be given to you in the question. And we will choose average rate of tax in India or foreign rate out of the two, whichever is lower. That lower of the two rate will be applied on doubly taxed income included in entity I. The lower of the two will be applied on doubly taxed income included in entity I. Doubly taxed income included in entity I. Lower of the two rates will be applied and that much will become your relief. It will be subtracted from your Indian tax liability. You have to be careful. It has to be included in entity. So from any of that doubly tax income, if you have taken any deduction, whether in India or in that country, then that much amount has not been doubly taxed. Only that much amount on which you have paid tax in both countries, that much is going to be taken. So if you have taken any Chapter 6A deduction specifically against your foreign income, that much will be reduced. However, if there is any expense related deduction, then you don't need to subtract. You can take your full foreign income. So doubly taxed income included in NTTI into lower of the two rates will become your unilateral relief under Section 91. Subtract it from your Indian tax liability, and that is going to give you your final tax liability. That's our chapter, double taxation relief, applicable both for paper 7 as well as paper 6. It is a part of international tax of paper 7 as well as 6. It is a chapter applicable for 130 marks paper if you have elected for international tax, and 30 marks if you have taken any other elective also. This is going to be a very, very important chapter. Let's go ahead. As I said, in the order of my textbook, next chapter in my textbook is a chapter called cash loans, 269 SS and 269 T, mode of acceptance and repayment of loan. No person shall take or accept 20,000 or more. Exact 20 is also covered. If you want to take a loan of 20,000 or more, you have to take an account pay check, account pay draft, or electronic mode through a bank account. And in all these places, wherever there is restriction on mode of transaction, whichever chapter, whether it is political party, business profession, capital gains, other sources, chapter 6A deduction, whenever there is a restriction on the mode of transaction, it will cover account pay check, account pay draft, electronic clearing system through a bank account. With that, we will now also cover other prescribed electronic modes, that is RuPay, debit card, Bheem, UPI. Such modes of payments will also be covered. That means you can take your cash loan in that, or 269T says if your outstanding amount is 20,000 or more, again exact 20,000 will also be covered, and you want to repay this loan, then the repayment also has to take place in the three allowable modes, where again there is the same amendment. If you do not comply, that means if you take a cash loan of 20,000 or more, or repay any outstanding loan of 20,000 or more in cash, then for violation of 269 SS, penalty will be attracted under 271D, and for violation of 269T, penalty will be attracted under 271E. In both cases, 100% of the amount accepted or 100% of the amount repaid, as the case may be, is going to be the penalty that is going to be attracted for violation of 269SS and 269T. Both these sections have got some exceptions. Some exceptions are given. Any loan taken or given, government, local authority, bank, if the lender and borrower are both farmers, any other notified, there are certain exceptions which have been notified. Otherwise, 100% penalty is going to be attracted. Very short and less important chapter. That was your chapter, cash loans, that is 269SS and 269T. Moving on, in the order of our chapters, next chapter that we have is a chapter called NRI taxation. In my textbook, NRI taxation. But all the students who have studied from me are aware that before I actually start the chapter NRI taxation, within the chapter NRI taxation, I do with students a lot of capital gains. So we are going to discuss and revise all that capital gain part here only. Later on, this will not be covered in the revision of capital gain. What do we do? First question, when does capital gain become long-term capital gain? When the asset is long-term capital asset. When does asset become long-term capital asset? When the holding period is greater than 36 months. But sometimes it will become long-term after greater than 12 months. Listed securities, but this will not cover units, because unit is separately covered. Point number two, units of equity-oriented mutual fund. And third, zero coupon bond. These three assets will become long-term after 12 months. And two assets that will become long-term after 24 months. That is unlisted shares and immovable property. In all the cases, whether 36, 12 or 24, equal to will go in short term. So it has to be greater than 36, 3 cases greater than 12, 2 cases greater than 24. In all the cases, equal to will go in short term capital gain. Are we clearly understanding what is happening? What happens when the asset is long term? The gain will become long term. If the capital gain becomes long term, we get two tax benefits. Benefit number one, the benefit of indexation. For the purpose of indexation, your base year will be previous year 0102, where the cost inflation index prescribed will be 100, and your exam year is going to be 1920, where the cost inflation index prescribed is 289. You will have to learn 100 and you will have to learn 289. In between it will be given to you. How to calculate index cost of acquisition? Take cost of acquisition. Multiply by CII of transfer year, which most probably is going to be your 1920, that is 289, divide by CII of acquisition. That's the first tax benefit of long-term capital gain. However, this tax benefit is not available in 7 cases. What are the 7 cases? First, bonds and debentures. Second, NRI taxation, the chapter which we will start now. Special rates of tax. Special rates of tax. Non-resident acquiring securities in India under normal provisions also, no indexation. 112A, stock market long-term capital gain. That is also, we will be discussing before we start NRI taxation. That is also part of my agenda year only. That is also part of my agenda year only. Slump sale and depreciable assets. 7 cases where the benefit of indexation is not going to be available, even if your asset is long term, even if your gain is long term. That was the first tax benefit. Our question number 2. First question is long term, short term. Second question is tax benefit of long term capital gain. Third question is also tax benefit of long term capital gain only, because there are 2 benefits. Question 2 and question 3. According to section 112, whenever you have long term capital gain, on that much part you will be paying tax at a rate of 20%. Special rate has been prescribed. Long term capital gain will be taxable at a rate of 20%. However, for 2 assets, listed securities excluding unit and zero coupon bond, instead of paying 20%, you can pay tax at 10%. You will lose the benefit of indexation. And as far as non-resident is concerned, if he is investing in securities in India, remember, he is never going to get indexation. If he is never going to get indexation, that means it is always going to be sale minus cost, and therefore we will always give him 10%. For a non-resident, it no longer works like an option. Whether listed or unlisted, he will not get indexation. He will pay tax at 10%. Non-resident on securities, no indexation, rate of tax is going to be 10%. No indexation, rate of tax is going to be 10%. Are we all clear about question number 3? And here only, we also discuss question number 4, capital gain on stock market trading. We discuss all this, then only we start NRI taxation chapter. Capital gain on stock market, only 3 assets are covered: equity shares, units of equity oriented mutual fund, and units of business trust. 3 assets, if sold on stock exchange, and STT is paid on the sale transaction. STT is paid on the sale transaction, then short term capital gain under 111A, 15%. Short term capital gain only has this much requirement. What requirement? Only 3 assets and STT should be paid on sale transaction. STCG has got only this much requirement. STCG has got only this much requirement. What is the requirement? Only 3 assets are covered. What is the requirement? Only 3 assets are covered, and securities transaction tax should be paid on the sale transaction, even if it is not paid on the purchase transaction. But for long term capital gain, 3 assets: equity shares, units of equity oriented mutual fund, units of business trust. STT has to be paid on sale transaction. And for equity shares purchased on or after 1/10/2004, STT has to be paid on purchase transaction also. Be very clear about STT becoming applicable on purchase transaction. First, it is applicable only for long term, not for short term. Second, it is applicable only for equity shares, not for the other 2 assets. Third, it is applicable only if the equity shares were purchased on or after 1/10/2004, because STT was not there in India before that date. And fourth, in this also there will be some notified exceptions like bonus shares, right shares, etc., which are directly purchased off market. So STT should be paid on purchase as well as the sale transaction for long term capital gain on equity shares purchased on or after 1/10/2004. Otherwise, STT has to be paid on sale. For short term, only on sale. In fact, for unit located in International Financial Services Center, that is IFSC, there is no requirement for STT on purchase or sale. It is immune from STT. Still, you will get the 2 benefits: short term capital gain 111A taxable at 15%, and long term capital gain, till a couple of years ago it was exempt under section 1038, but now we are aware that this long term capital gain is going to be taxable. So sale consideration will be actual, that is the STT paid sale consideration. When we take cost of acquisition, we will be getting the benefit of grandfathering. What is the benefit of grandfathering? The cost, the actual cost or the fair market value on 31st January 2018, that is one day before the budget day, whichever is higher. That means any gain that got accrued before the budget announcement will not be taxable. So ideally the rule is cost on FMV on 31st January, whichever is higher. But wait, that it is possible that after the budget announcement, the market price has fallen and the FMV earlier was higher. That cannot and should not become a factor for booking a loss. And therefore, our first step while subtracting cost of acquisition is going to be FMV or selling price, whichever is lower. And that lower amount will be compared with actual cost of acquisition, whichever is higher. So, selling price will be actual, cost price will be FMV or selling price, whichever is lower, compared with actual cost, whichever is higher, that will become our cost. Because we are giving the benefit of grandfathering, there will be no indexation here. This will be your long-term capital gain under section 112A. Wait. This full amount will go in your income, in your capital gains, in your gross total income, in your net taxable total income. Full amount, if it is 5 lakh, 10 lakh, 12 lakh, whatever be the amount, full amount will be going. When we will calculate tax liability, from this amount we will subtract 1 lakh and calculate 10%. The benefit of 1 lakh is available at the time of tax calculation. In your income, the entire amount will be going. In your income, we will not be sending the capital gain minus 1 lakh. Income will have full amount. At tax calculation, we will give you benefit of 1 lakh, and only on the gain exceeding rupees 1 lakh, we will be applying 10%. Because we are already giving you this 1 lakh benefit, then against your 112A long term capital gain, you are not allowed to take rebate under 87A, is not allowed against this income. Apart from that, we are aware obviously that whenever an income is taxable at a special rate, whether it is 111A, 112A or any other income, if an income is taxable at special rate, then chapter 6A deduction is not going to be available, is not going to be available against this income. 111A, 112A, 112 normal long term capital gain is also special rate only. And second, two people, resident individual, resident HUF, two people, that is resident individual, resident HUF, against three incomes, 111A income, 112 income and 112A incomes, two people against three incomes are allowed to utilize their unexhausted basic exemption limit. Only two people, only against three incomes, are allowed to utilize their unexhausted basic exemption limit. This is where we declared the discussion on capital gains before our NRI taxation chapter over. We do all this in our NRI taxation, so that later on we don't have to do all this in our capital gains chapter. Now the time comes to actually start the main chapter, NRI taxation. Very quickly, specific assessee, specific income combo has special rate. So if the combo does not take place, normal assessee, normal income, normal rate. Normal assessee, specific income, normal rate. Specific assessee, normal income, normal rate. Only when the combo has taken place, special rate will apply. But in this chapter, the special rate is optional. So if combo does not take place, normal rate compulsory. If combo takes place, normal rate or special rate, whichever is beneficial. What is the combo? Who is the specific assessee? Who is the specific assessee in this chapter? Individual specific assessee is NRI. Individual, who can be citizen or PIO, any one of them, non-resident during the year. Individual means the natural person. Citizen and PIO, multiple ways. Citizen you can become by birth, parents' birth, honorary, green card. And PIO, person of Indian origin, if you, your parents or your grandparents, father's side grandparents and mother's side grandparents, out of 7 people, if anyone was born in undivided India, then you will be PIO. For this, you have to be citizen, PIO, any one of them. It is not necessary that you have to be both. So, individual, citizen, PIO, anyone and non-resident. How does one become resident? 182 days in the current year or 60 days in the current year and 365 days in the last 4 years. If you satisfy any one of them, you become resident. But for this chapter, you will have to become non-resident. Therefore, you will have to dissatisfy both the conditions. And there are two cases where condition 2, 63, 65 is not applicable. Citizen or PIO, living in India, going outside for employment, earning or crew member of Indian ship. And second, citizen of India, living abroad, coming for a visit. And for crew member, the continuous discharge certificate period shall be excluded from the physical presence in India. For these two people, condition 2 is not applicable. Therefore, they will become resident only by satisfying condition 1, that is 182 days. And they will become non-resident by dissatisfying condition 1, that is 182 days. So, individual, citizen, PIO, anyone and non-resident during the year is the specific assessee. For becoming ROR, there are two more conditions not relevant in NRI taxation, because here you have to become non-resident. But that ROR, RNOR condition helps us in assessment procedure. So, that's just I am telling you the two conditions. Once you are a resident, you can become ROR how? Satisfy two conditions, both conditions cumulative. First condition, last 7 years you should have been in India for a period of 730 days or more. And second condition, out of last 10 years, at least 2 years you should have been a resident. Then you will become R01. But this discussion is relevant for assessment procedure. In NRI taxation, the requirement is to become non-resident, under which there is no ordinary, not ordinary bifurcation. This was our specific assessing. Let's talk about specific incomes. What are the specific incomes that are covered and taxable in this chapter? Two incomes. Investment income and long-term capital gain arising out of a foreign exchange asset. So our first task is going to be understanding the meaning of forex asset. What is forex asset? Shares of an Indian company, debentures of an Indian public company, deposits of an Indian public company, central government securities, any other notified asset. Investment income will be taxable at 20%. If there is any exempt income like dividend, you will ignore that obviously. Investment income will be taxable at 20% and long-term capital gain will be taxable at 10%. Investment income 20%, LTCG 10%. Any other income will be taxable at normal rates. Combo does not take place, normal rates. Any other will include short term, because if special rate is prescribed only for long term capital gain, that means short term capital gain will be taxable as per normal rates of tax. Short term capital gain will be taxable at normal rates of tax. Are we clear? Both these rates, 20% for investment income and 10% for long term capital gain, are rates of basic tax. If applicable, surcharge will be added and HEC is always going to get added. But when you are opting for these rates are optional. These rates are optional. Remember, you will have to face some restriction. Let's talk about investment income first. You won't get any deduction of expense. You will not get any basic exemption. You will not get any chapter 6A. But if you go for normal provisions, you will get deduction of expense. You will get basic exemption. You will get chapter 6A also. If we talk about long-term capital gains, you will get deduction of expense. That restriction cannot apply here, because if we apply that restriction, we will end up taxing selling price. We will get deduction of transfer expense, cost of acquisition, everything. We will not get indexation benefit. And obviously the other two are same. So no indexation, no basic exemption, no chapter 6A. Right now only I told you, chapter 6A not available against special rates of tax, and basic exemption facilities available only for resident individual and resident HUF. So no indexation, no basic exemption, no chapter 6A. If he goes for normal rates, still no indexation because all are securities. Still no chapter 6A, because for LTCG the normal rate is also special. And no basic exemption because that facility is available only for resident. That means as far as LTCG is concerned, whether you take normal or special does not make any difference. Both cases no basic exemption, both cases no chapter 6A, both cases no indexation. But deduction of expenses will be available. That is disallowed only under investment income, that also only under special provisions. If you go for normal provisions, you will get deduction of expense, basic exemption, chapter 6A, all this. So if you opt for the special rates, you have to be careful about these things. Otherwise, you have the option normal or special, whichever is beneficial. Then next provision 115F told us that if there is LTCG in this chapter, you don't want to pay tax, invest in another forex asset up within a period of 6 months. If you invest that, you will get exemption. If your net sale consideration is invested, entire capital gain will be exempt, otherwise proportionate. So you have to invest your sale amount, not your gain amount. 115G, a very very important section. If you do not have any other taxable income and TDS is fully deducted, no other income TDS fully deducted, no need to file ROI. There are altogether 4 such cases in income tax. One is NRI, remaining 3 in the next chapter, special rates of tax. If there is no other income and TDS has been fully deducted, no need to file ROI. Obviously, the provisions are optional, that is written in 115I. And after you become resident, you will still get the beneficial tax rates if you were non-resident at the time of purchase. If you were non-resident at the time of acquisition of your forex asset, then later on, even if you become resident, the beneficial tax provisions are still going to be available. The option is still going to be available. Do we remember that? Beneficial tax provisions after becoming resident also. This was your chapter called NRI taxation. NRI taxation. Let's go ahead. Next chapter, special rates of tax. First of all, the concept is somewhat similar. If the combo does not take place, normal rates. But if the combo takes place, here the special rate, this is the difference, here the special rate will be compulsory. So every section there will be an assessee, income and rate. If the combo does not take place, normal assessee, normal income, normal rate. Specific assessee, normal income, normal rate. normal assessee specific income, normal rate. If the combo takes place, specific assessee specific income, then only the special rate is going to be applicable. But this time it is going to be compulsory. The moment it is compulsory, what are the basic points of the chapter? No deduction of expense, no basic exemption, no chapter 6A. Wherever there will be any long-term capital gain, no indexation. All the rates are basic tax rates. So obviously, you have to add surcharge and cess at the applicable rates. If there is DTAA, you can take the benefit. Then it will not be compulsory. Compulsory compared to normal rates of tax. But DTAA or this will, whichever is beneficial, obviously is going to be available. And whenever we are discussing any special rate, it is only if the income is taxable. Supposingly the income has been exempt because of any provision of the, because of any provision, if the income has been exempt, if the income is exempt because of any provision, then there is no question of deciding whether there will be normal tax or special tax. If it is exempt, then the story is then and there over. Are we all clear about this? Now, one by one the sections, the most important section, section 115A, non-resident or foreign company. First income, dividend income, because it is exempt. 115 BBDA is also not applicable. Foreign dividend also not taxable. That used to be only one dividend, 222E, but now that is covered in 30% DDT. So in that case nothing is going to be taxable. Ignore it. Second income, income in the form of interest. Interest income of non-residents in India is taxable at a rate of 20%. However, in four exceptional cases. What are the four exceptional cases? First, interest from infrastructure debt fund. Second, from Indian company doing any business, long-term finance and approved agreement. Third, interest from business trust. And fourth, interest paid to qualified foreign investor. Four cases, it is going to be 5%. In every other case, the interest income will be taxable at 20%. But here, a couple of amendments have taken place. One amendment, if the interest is in rupee denominated bonds as qualified foreign investor and the bonds were issued during the period 17th September 18 to 31st March 19. Listen, that means the issue has taken place before your previous year 1920 started. But we don't have to see the previous year of earning income. We have to see the issue period. If the bonds were issued during that period 17 September 18 to 31st March 19, then the interest income on rupee denominated bonds will be exempt. So obviously income will arise now in 1920. We don't have to see the income period. We have to see the issue period. Issued during, last time I am saying the period, 17th September 18 to 31st March 19, issued during that period, then interest will be exempt. Second, non-resident earning interest on IFSC from 1st September 19, that will also be exempt. Non-resident having interest income on IFSC, that will also be exempt. So in all the tax benefits available under IFSC, one new benefit, non-resident earning interest income, that is also going to be now exempt. And IFSC itself will get a chapter 6A deduction 80LA. Under section 80LA, IFSC will get 100% deduction of profits 10 consecutive years out of first 15 years. So you have to be careful. It is only 10 years. They have to be continuous. You cannot take 1, 3, 5, 7. No, it has to be 10 continuous and out of first 15. So your only options are 1 to 10, 2 to 11, 3 to 12, 4 to 13, 5 to 14 and 6 to 15. 10 years, continuous years out of first 15 years, 100% deduction of profits is going to be available. 100% deduction of profits to IFSC, and this will work as an exception to the rule where against special rates of tax you don't get deduction, but this deduction for IFSC is going to be available under 80LA. So that is also an amendment. And in this section 115A, third income royalty, fourth income fees for technical services, both of them will be taxable at a rate of 10%. But remember, first, against this also chapter 6A is available. This is also an exception. Chapter 6A will be available. Second, from National Technical Research Organization, royalty FTS will be exempt. And third, 44DA, if you have permanent establishment books of accounts and audit, then you get one more option. Take deduction of expense and pay tax at 40%. Already 115A is there without deduction of expense 10%, but option 2, take deduction of expense and pay tax at 40%. You have got one more option available, but this option is available only if you have books of accounts, PE in India, and you are getting them audited. Otherwise, only one option, 115A, tax rate is going to be 10% without any deduction of expense. 10% tax without any deduction of expense. Are we clear about this? Next section, 115AB, overseas financial organization or offshore funds. Foreign investors who come to India and take SEBI approval and invest in Indian markets by buying mutual fund units, not directly. So, share of profit from mutual fund 10%. But that is irrelevant because once the mutual fund pays IDT, it will be exempt. You have to ignore it. Long-term capital gains without indexation will be taxable at a rate of 10%. Only two incomes are given. So short-term will be taxable at normal rates. Anything else will be taxable at normal rates. 115AC, non-resident. Income from bonds. Notified bonds of a public sector company or bonds of a notified Indian company. Taxable at 10%. Income from ADR, GDR. Taxable at 10%. And long-term capital gain on both these assets also 10%, but without getting the benefit of indexation. And everything else including short-term will be taxable at normal rates. Next, 115ACA. For the first time in the chapter, assessee will be resident. Resident employees of an Indian company or subsidiary of Indian company in the business of specified knowledge-based industry or service. What is knowledge-based industry or service? IT software, IT service, biotechnology, pharmaceutical, entertainment and any other notified. If the company is doing the business, it is specified industry, the employee will become specific assessee only if resident. First income, income from ADR, GDR received in exchange of employer company securities. And how were the securities allotted? By way of ESOP, 10% tax. Second income, long term capital gain on transfer of this ADR, GDR, 10% without indexation. Any other income, taxable at normal rates including short term capital gain. Next, section 115AD, FIIs. Now, what is FII? Foreign investor, SEBI approval and allowed to acquire any kind of securities in the market. So, from those securities, you will earn income. If it is dividend, it is exempt. All other investment income will be taxable at 20%, but if earned as QFI, 5%. So, investment income will be classified in three categories. Dividend income exempt, as QFI, 5%, everything else 20%. Long-term capital gain will be 10% without indexation and you can take benefit of 112A also, which is also 10% without indexation, but you get that 1 lakh advantage at the time of tax calculation. The only section in the chapter where there is special rate for short-term capital gain also, if covered under 111A then 15%, if not covered under 111A then 30%. The only section where there is special rate for short-term capital gain also. Do we recollect that? Fantastic. Next, section 115BB, casual winnings for all assessees will be taxable at a rate of 30%. Next, section 115BBA, non-resident foreign national sportsman, game or sport advertisement articles, 20%. Second, non-resident foreign sports association, guaranteed amount, 20%. Third, non-resident foreign national entertainer in respect of performances in India, 20%. All these three incomes will be taxable at a rate of, 20%, and the same TDS also has to be deducted. Also remember that this benefit is not available for umpires, coaches, etc. They will get covered under normal rates of tax. And third point, 115A, first very important section, 115AC and 115BBA. These three are those sections of special rates of tax where if there is no other taxable income and TDS has been fully deducted, then there is not going to be any return filing. So four cases, first NRI and three in special rates, totally four cases. Conditions are same. If there is no other taxable income and TDS is fully deducted, then no need to file your return of income. Do we remember now? Are we clear about that issue? That was your 115BBA. Next section, 115BBD. If an Indian company receives dividend from a foreign company where it is holding 26% or more, what should be the minimum holding percentage? Minimum 26% or more if held in a foreign company, then the dividend income received from there will be taxable at a concessional rate of 15%. So it won't be taxable at normal rates. We will give you benefit of concessional rate of tax, that is 15%. 115BBDA, if a resident, excluding charitable trust, medical educational institution and domestic companies, and only resident, non-resident not covered, if you are earning dividend on which company has paid DDT at a rate of 15%, only 15% dividend is covered. So, foreign dividend will not be covered and 222E is 30%, that will also not be covered, only 15%. And if your total is exceeding 10%, if your total is exceeding 10 lakh rupees, then the excess will be taxable at 10%. So, residents have to divide their dividend in three categories. Foreign dividend, every rupee is taxable, no limit of 10 lakh. 222E, crores of rupees also exempt. And everything else that will be 15% DDT up to 10 lakh exempt and excess over 10 lakh will be taxable at 10%. That's your section 115BBDA. If you have earned DDT paid dividend, that will include your interim dividend, final dividend, equity, preference, 222ABCD also, because 222ABCD are also covered in 15% DDT. It is 222E which is covered under 30% DDT. So if the total is more than 10 lakh, then excess over 10 lakh will be taxable at 10%. Do we remember that now? All of us. 115 BBE, unexplained cash credit income investment expenditure 60%. Compulsory surcharge 25% irrespective of amount and 4% HEC, 78% tax. 115 BBF, royalty on residence from patents. Royalty for residence on patents, true and first inventor. You have to be true and first inventor. You have an option. This is an optional section. 10%, or if you want, you can go to normal provisions also. This is only an option for the true and first inventor. If you take this section, you have to opt for minimum 5 more years. And if you leave in between, you won't get this section for 5 more years. Last section, 115 BBG, transfer of carbon credits for all assessees will be taxable at 10%. That was your chapter, special rates of tax. Let's go, order of the textbook, next chapter. DDT, in this same chapter, we will be doing IDT and buyback tax also. DDT is covered under 115 OPQ. IDT is covered under 115 RST. And buyback tax is covered under 115 QA, QB, QC. In all the three cases, the first section 115 R for IDT, O for DDT and QA for BBT is the charging section. But the second section is the late payment interest. So if you don't pay within 14 days, 1% per month or part of a month interest will get attracted on DDT, IDT, BBT, all three. And the third section is about SSE in default. 115 Q for DDT, T for IDT and QC for buyback tax. That is the section for SSE in default. So second section about interest, third section about SSE in default, that we finish at the beginning of the chapter. Now we will talk about the three main sections. 115 O about DDT, R about IDT and QA about buyback tax. Every domestic company, DDT is attracted only on domestic company. What is domestic company? All Indian companies plus foreign companies that have made arrangement for distribution of dividend in India. Every domestic company will have to pay dividend distribution tax on actual dividend, whether interim or finance, interim or final equity or preference at 15%. 222 ABCD also 15%, but 222E at 30%. So only 222E is separate. For this, I will have to first tell you what is deemed dividend. 222 A, B, C, D, E. 222A, company transferring asset to shareholder. This is secret transfer of profit. Fair market value of the asset transferred. But maximum to the extent of free reserves. Maximum to the extent of free reserves, including bonus, will be your deemed dividend on this 15%. 222C was also same only, except that the company is undergoing liquidation. Because the company is undergoing liquidation, shareholder will have capital gains also. Fair market value of asset received minus deemed dividend will be selling price and actual cost price of shares. And whenever the asset is sold in future, selling price will be actual and full FMV will be taken as cost price. 222B was about any distribution free of cost to preference shareholders, that is bonus debentures or bonus shares, and for equity shareholders only bonus debentures. 222D you can ignore. These four cases are 15% DDT. And what was 222E? Loan, advance or deposit taken by a beneficial shareholder from a private company or a business in which the beneficial shareholder has got substantial interest. In both these cases it will be 222E. Earlier it used to be taxable for the shareholder, now it will be taxable for the company, that also 30%. So actual and ABCD 15% DDT, that is why we include in 115 BBDA, because government has received only 15%, so they want 10% more on excess over 10 lakh. But 222E, government has got 30%, and because government has got 30%, it won't be taxable at all, it will be fully exempt, not even included for 115 BBDA purposes. And there is one more difference. The 15% DDT is subjected to grossing up. So your calculation will be 15 upon 85. But in 30% DDT, there is no grossing up. It is already a very high rate. So 30 upon 100. So actual, whether equity or preference, whether interim or final. And 222 ABCD, dividend into 15 by 85. And 222E will be dividend into 30 by 100. This will be your basic DDT. In DDT, IDT, buyback tax, surcharge will always come irrespective of amount. 12% surcharge and 4% HEC is always going to get attracted. This is how section 115O, that is calculation of DDT, works. The few general points to be noted about DDT. First, DDT is compulsory even if your income tax is exempt. Once the company pays DDT, then shareholder will get exemption subject to 115 BBDA. There will be no deduction of DDT. It is direct tax. There will be no deduction available to anybody. Next, when a business trust is holding 100% in special purpose vehicle, do we still remember? Business trust holding 100% in special purpose vehicle, then there will be no DDT on the special purpose vehicle if the distribution is out of current profits. Next, no DDT on IFSC. This is an existing rule. Just a small clarification that whether the distribution is out of current profits or accumulated profits, no DDT on IFSC. And last, 1150 subsection 1, which is important, which is always tested in sums. Any dividend received from your subsidiary company will be subtracted before applying DDT. So, when we take our dividend declared, from our dividend declared, we subtract two dividends. Dividend received from domestic subsidiary, if the domestic subsidiary has paid DDT, and dividend received from foreign subsidiary, it has to be a subsidiary, there cannot be paid DDT, but we have paid tax, 115 BBDA, because it is subsidiary, it has to be 26% or more. So, foreign subsidiary as well as domestic subsidiary, both dividends will be subtracted. Mind you, it has to be subsidiary. Non-subsidiary won't be subtracted. And for domestic subsidiary, the subsidiary should have paid DDT. After we subtract these two things, then we will apply the rates of DDT. It's a very important provision. Second tax of the chapter, income distribution tax. Every mutual fund, when it distributes profits to its unit holders, it will have to pay income distribution tax. For equity-oriented fund, rate is 10%, infrastructure fund paying to non-resident 5%, and in all other cases, if unit holder is individual HUF, then 25%, if unit holder is other than individual HUF, then 30%. All these rates are subject to grossing up. Because the rates are subject to grossing up, then what is going to be the calculation? 10 by 90, 5 by 95, 25 by 75, 30 by 70. 12% surcharge compulsory, 4% HSC is going to be compulsory. Here that amendment has taken place. Here that amendment has taken place. There will be no IDT on IFSC. So no DDT was already there. Now there will be no IDT also on IFSC. That amendment has taken place. And the points to be noted are same. So IDT is also compulsory even if income tax is exempt. Once IDT is paid, unit holders will get exemption under 1035 and no deduction for IDT also because it is direct tax. Let's go to the third tax of the chapter, buyback tax. Whenever there is buyback of unlisted shares, and first of all, a big amendment taken place over here. Now buyback tax will be applicable on buyback of listed shares also. So buyback tax will apply on unlisted as well as listed. But wait, that amendment came on the budget day 5th July, which was the final budget. So, listed shares will suffer buyback only if the buyback has taken place on or after 5th July. Any buyback. Now, you need to know the full law of 1920. So, you need to know 1st April to 4th July and you need to know 5th July and subsequent also. Are we clear about that? So, unlisted shares full year there will be buyback tax. Listed shares till 4th July there will be no buyback tax. From 5th July there will be buyback tax. But wait, this came in the budget on 5th July. But some companies had already announced their buyback of listed shares and they were aware that there will be no BBT. Now suddenly we are bringing BBT from 5th July. Then in the ordinance, so the listed shares will suffer, listed shares will suffer buyback tax amendment came in the budget. But the ordinance brought another change. They said if the public announcement was done before 5th July, then listed will also not suffer buyback tax. So listen, let me be clear. Unlisted full year there will be buyback tax. Listed till 4th July there will be no buyback tax. From 5th July there will be buyback tax. But if the public announcement was happened before 5th July, then on such buyback even after 5th July there will be no buyback tax. 20%, but your 20% is not on the payment. You have to calculate the capital gain of the shareholder. On that capital gain 20% without grossing up. So it will be 20 by 100. Compulsory surcharge of 12%. Your surcharge is going to be compulsory attracted at 12% and HEC is also going to compulsory attract at 4%. That is going to be your buyback tax. Other points to be noted are same. It is compulsory even if the income tax is exempt. Buyback tax is compulsory even if your income tax is exempt. No deduction, and once the buyback tax is paid for the shareholder, the exemption will be under section 1034A. Section 10 subsection 34A, it is going to be exempt. That was our chapter DDT, IDT and buyback tax. Let's go further. Order of the textbook. Next chapter, special economic zone. Very quickly I will tell you, subject to certain conditions. If you are doing export of any goods from SEZ or providing services, then we will do a calculation. First, we will calculate the qualifying amount. What is the qualifying amount? Profit into export turnover upon total turnover. Profit into export turnover upon total turnover. First 5 years, we will give you 100% deduction. Year 6 to 10, we will give you 50% deduction. There is a stupid deduction from year 11 to 15, but it has got lot of conditions. Nobody takes that. This is subject to certain conditions. Your business should be incorporated during a certain period, not splitting up or reconstruction of an existing business. Second and local plant and machinery, maximum 20%. Same business, you cannot take 10AA and 35AD, both deductions. You have to file your ROI on time. You have to get a CA report. Inter-business transfer should take place at fair market value. Subject to these conditions, you are going to get deduction. First 5 years 100%, year 6 to 10 50%, but of what amount? Not entire profit, your qualifying amount. And what is qualifying amount? Profit into export turnover upon total turnover is going to be your qualifying amount. That is your buyback tax, taxation of buyback. Are we clear about the taxation on buyback? All of us? I'm saying buyback, I've gone mad. That was your chapter, special economic zone. Sorry, cut. That was your chapter called special economic zone. Special economic zone. Are we clear about the special economic zone? Small chapter, it will never come as a full-fledged question. It may come as MCQ or as a small adjustment in a big question. Other than that, there is no weightage of this chapter. Are we clear about the chapter? All of us? Let's go ahead. Next. Assessment of business trust. Business trust, two types, REIT and InvIT. Unit holders will buy the units and then these business trusts will invest further. REIT will buy shares, debentures in the property market and InvIT will buy shares, debentures in the infrastructure market. REIT can have own property also. All incomes will be taxable for the business trust. All incomes will be taxable for the business trust except one, dividend income, because the company will pay DDT. Second, interest received from special purpose vehicle. What is a special purpose vehicle? A company where you are holding more than 50%, that is controlling interest. And third, rental income only for REIT. So first let's talk about the taxable incomes. Can I say excluding these three, everything is taxable? If you are eligible for 111A, take that benefit. If you are eligible for 112, take that benefit. Everything else will be taxable at maximum marginal rate. This year, maximum marginal rate obviously will be 30% plus 37% surcharge plus 4% HEC. Maximum marginal rate will become 42.744. Everything will be taxable at MMR except 111A and 112. Now let's talk about those incomes which are exempt. Dividend income. Why is it exempt? Company is paying DDT. But if it is 100% SPV, then the company will also get immunity. That transaction will go tax free throughout. And the remaining two incomes, interest from special purpose vehicle and rent. Who will pay tax on these incomes? Unit holder. Resident unit holders, both incomes will be taxable at normal rates. Non-resident unit holder. Rent will be taxable at normal rate. Interest will be taxable at 5%, 115A. And whenever we are making payment, TDS will be deducted again. If the unit holder is resident, 10% for both incomes. If it is non-resident, for rental income, applicable rates, and for interest income, 5% plus surcharge plus HEC. And finally, one fine day when the unit holder will transfer the units, compulsorily listed. So STT will be paid. Once you pay STT, it will be covered under 111A if short-term capital gain and 112A if long-term capital gain, because 111A, 112A cover equity shares, units of equity-oriented mutual fund and units of business trust. So these three assets will be covered. Capital gain on business trust will also be covered over there in 111A, 112A. That was our chapter called Assessment of Business Trust. Next chapter, Assessment of Investment Funds. Concept is majorly same. Here also, unit holders will invest in the investment fund. Investment fund will invest further in the markets. Here there is no restriction. It can be any market, not like real estate or infrastructure. What is the taxation rules? Business income, taxation rule is that business income will be taxable for the investment fund and all other incomes will be taxable in the unit holders in proportion. In proportion, it will be taxable for the unit holders, whether distributed or not distributed. That is called the treatment of pass-through treatment. But a big amendment has taken place, a fundamental amendment with respect to loss set-off and carry-forward. Till now, all the loss set-off and carry-forward task was being done by the investment fund only, but now this rule will change. If there is any current year loss, first set off, no, because carry forward comes after set off. First set off that investment fund will do. After set off, when we carry forward, investment fund will now carry forward only the business loss. All other losses, just like other incomes, the losses will also be given in pass through. So, it is in fact fair, because business loss remains with investment fund, business profit will also remain with investment fund. Other incomes we are doing pass through, then losses also pass through, so that unit holder against the income can take the benefit of the loss. So, listen, first let's talk about current year. Current year loss, first step set off, balance carry forward. In carry forward, business loss will be carried forward by investment fund, because profit also we only pay tax, but other losses we will give pass through. In that they have added a point that if any unit holder has acquired the unit in the current year, that is held for less than 12 months, then that loss will lapse. Neither investment fund nor unit holder, nobody will get. That much loss will lapse. And now this rule is changing from 1920. That means obviously there were brought forward losses, because in the earlier years the carry forward was being done by the investment fund. That means as on 31st March 19, there will be some brought forward losses of the investment fund. In that, business loss will continue as it is for the remaining period out of 8 years. Everything as per set off and carry forward chapter. All this will strictly work as per the rules given in set off. But the other losses, till now it was being carried forward by the investment fund, but now we will send it in pass through. And here that 12 months rule is not applicable. So other losses will be pass through, but obviously unit holders can carry forward only for the remaining period. So, if whatever number of years investment fund has already carried forward, first go and check in set off chapter how many years are allowed. Whatever years investment fund has carried forward, reduce those many months, and then only the balance number of years investment fund, the unit holders will be getting the benefit of carry forward. That was our chapter, assessment of investment funds. Next chapter, dividend and bonus stripping, 947, 948, very small chapter, quickly I will tell you. If you have purchased any shares or units, 947 first, dividend stripping. Within shares within 3 months or units within 3 months before the record date you have purchased, and sold shares within 3 months or units within 9 months after the record date, then the loss on sale shall be ignored to the extent of exempt income, and only the balance will be available for set off and carry forward. And as far as bonus stripping is concerned, it applies only to units, and that also only if bonus units were allotted. So, purchase within 3 months and sale within 9 months after the record date. If the original units are sold, the loss will be ignored and they will become cost of acquisition of whatever balance units you have with you. Whatever balance units you have with you. That is our dividend and bonus stripping chapter. Very small chapter, so not much discussion on this. Next chapter is our chapter called assessment of partnership firms. Everything about partnership firm is given over here. Basic tax is going to be flat rate of 30%. Surcharge only after 1 crore, only one rate 12%, no amendment over here. 0 to 1 crore, no surcharge, more than 1 crore, 12% surcharge, absolutely no amendment has taken place. As far as partnership firm is concerned, HEC 4%, always share of profit received by partner will be exempt, everything will be taxable, everything else will be taxable under PGBP. Whatever is allowed as a deduction to the firm will be taxable in the hands of the partner. 44AD is available to firm but not available to LLP. The most important provision of this chapter is going to be 40B, the limit of interest deduction and remuneration deduction. Yes, there are some other few concepts like a change in constitution, succession, and all those concepts you can just go through. They are not required to be revised. The main concept that I am revising with you, that concept which you can leave the full chapter but you need to revise, that concept, the provision of 40B, limit on deduction for interest and remuneration paid by firm to partner. This is also applicable to LLP. Every provision is same except that LLP does not get 44AD. So, for interest, whether paid to working or non-working partner, it will be allowed. Actual 12% simple interest or as per deed. Actual as per deed or 12% per annum simple interest, whichever is lower. And for remuneration, actual deed or the third amount requires hard work. First, calculate book profit or book loss. If it is book loss, it will be 150, not the final answer, the third limit. If actual is lower, it will be whichever is lower. And in case of book profit, first 3,90%, balance 60%, but still it will never be below 1,50,000. Actual deed or this third amount, whichever is lower, will become your allowable remuneration deduction. And whatever, and only if it is working partner, sleeping partner fully disallowed. And whatever is allowed as a deduction to the firm, only that much is going to be taxable in the hands of the partner. Whatever is allowed as a deduction to the firm, only that much will be taxable in the hands of the partner. Are we all clear about this? So, that was our chapter, assessment of partnership firm. We will It's been more than an hour, so we will cut our part 1. This will be declared as end of part 1 of your revision lecture. We will continue in our revision lecture in the upcoming parts, further parts. Thank you.